this talk's probably a little bit different in terms of the style, shall we say, than from a lot of the other presentations you're seeing here. That's just what I'm going to invite you to talk, we'll see. In the sense that I'm not going to be just giving recipes or code fragments on how you can do this certain thing or other in your shop. What I'm really going to be discussing is what I would call a full-blown methodology. So therefore, I would not expect you to walk away from this talk knowing exactly what to do. This is more to give you an overview and some insights as to the sort of thing you can do. I've tried to make it as simple as possible. In fact, I don't think it's really possible to make any simpler. And therefore, yes, you have absolute potential to use this stuff, but don't expect to walk away, just immediately start using it. That's the industrious people that walk away from classes and talk so big people, so it can happen. So we're going to be discussing scalability. Let me try to distinguish these terms a little bit because why I'm doing this presentation in this particular style. So what I'm going to try and show you is what I regard as a practical methodology. Methodology implies there's several pieces that have to fit together, and you'll see why I hope as we go on. And the point about that is that you need a methodology to assess things like cost benefit for any given scalability strategy. So if you read Theo Schlossnagel's book, for example, or John Oswald's book, you may get various ideas for some kind of scalability strategy. The question is, who's got the better idea, which is the most cost effective? Should I use Theo's or should I use John's, for example? And the only way you can do that is by quantifying what's going on. And I would say probably without exception, this is not a criticism, but probably without exception in everything I've seen so far, this kind of quantification is not done. I think it's just because people don't know how to do it, so that's what I'm going to try and show you. So I want to quantify system scalability. That means I want to attach numbers to things in some way. And the other sort of cardinal sin which I've seen committed here, like in every presentation, is that people plot out various numbers such as, you know, some throughput number, how many hits per second, or page views per second, or maybe a latency response time. These are single numbers, which is fine. They certainly exist, and I don't doubt the value of the number. What I'm quibbling with is that to understand scalability, I really need to know a set of numbers, because scalability is not a number, it's a function. And the function is defined as a magnitude number, so I need to know more than one number. I'll explain more about that in a second. So the other point about it is that one encouraging thing I see is that people are talking about doing measurements on their websites or facilities. That's great. Even ignoring questions about tools and techniques and all that stuff, that's a separate discussion, which people have been talking about here, which is just great. The thing that I think most people don't understand is that all measurements are wrong, by definition. I'll let you think about what I mean by that statement, we'll come back to that later. So if all measurements are wrong by definition, you need to know how wrong they are. If you don't know how wrong they are, then you really need to find one, actually. So part of this methodology is to attach values so that you can get some idea of how wrong these numbers are. So to do that, you need a framework of some kind. And in this game, capacity planning and performance analysis, this is a well-known discipline. We didn't just invent it. What's encouraging is that people who are developing websites and so on are actually showing interest in this kind of thing. Hence this comp, which is great to see. So the framework here means model. Of course, model is one of the most overloaded words in the English language. It means everything from model Frankenstein to Christy Brinkley or something like that. So I have to define what I mean by a model, and I'm going to do that. Because when I take the measurements that other people have been discussing and combine that with the right kind of model, then I get real information, because data ain't not information. It's not the same thing. So another point, just before I proceed, is, you know, what do I mean by scalability? This is a little bit tough, because I don't think there's any real single definition. But what I mean here is some kind of sustainable performance under increasing load. I sort of tweaked that. You can't talk about scalability without mentioning the word size. But of course you can't, because scaling means to do with size. Here, size means the load, typically traffic rates, hit rates, whatever. And I'm going to parameterize that by a symbol. I like symbols because it makes the thinking that much easier. So I'm going to symbolize it by N, as you'll see, that will just keep cropping up. So that's what I'm going to parameterize by value of size. And I want to look at scalability as a function of size. Many people don't know the story of Jack and the Beanstalk. You all do. That's good. I have such a feeling this is a British Commonwealth fairy tale. I never heard of it in the United States. A lot of people haven't heard of it. So you know the story about Jack goes up this, gets his magic beans and goes up in the clouds of this giant beanstalk, and there's a giant that has pots of gold or whatever, and Jack comes from a poor family, you know, and the giant chases him down the beanstalk and all this jazz. So I can ask a simple question. Where are all the giants? Why do we have to read about these things in fairy tales? And if I look in the real world, I can't find what we call giants. They're not as big as Jack's giant. Jack's giant is something like 30 feet tall, if you try to figure out the fairy tale. The tallest guy on record, as far as I know, is this guy who's now deceased, I think the current guy who doesn't hold the Guinness record that he is alive is a Chinese guy. So this fellow was 8 feet 11, and what you're not seeing here is covered up is the fact that he's wearing leg braces. His own legs actually have difficulty supporting his actual body weight. You can't see that on the track. By the way, the guy on his right is dear old dad. So Jack is, let's say, nearly 2 meters tall, weighs, let's say, 1 kilogram, I'm just going to use metric, this is just using a multiply by 10. If the giant in the Jack and the Beanstalk story was 10 times bigger than that, then he would end up weighing a bone crushing 100 tons. So you'd have to have, you know, pretty thick legs and quite these big arms. You know, these are fake, by the way. These are just a quite nuisance because they're completely hollow. They're not marbled, so they don't support any load. So Galileo actually, you know, 400 or 500 years ago, figured out that there's an important conception underneath all of this business about, you know, how big can a giant be. That wasn't the question he was addressing. What he was addressing was how big could they build ships. And Galileo realized that the two functions you have to look at are, one, the volume of the system, how big is it going to be physically, because it will have a certain weight, a certain mass. And the other one is, what cross-sectional area is needed to support that weight. And very simply, you can imagine, if I take the length of a ruler, then if I'm going to measure the volume, then I must be measuring a cubic quantity. So I've shown that as delta cube here, the volume. If I'm looking at the strength as it relates to the cross-sectional area, then I must go as the square of L, as an area. And it turns out that even civil engineers know that physical systems have an inherent critical limit to their scalability because they can only sustain loads up to a certain point. Beyond that point, things tend to break. So these blocks here are not supporting any load whatsoever, purely decoration, because they're just completely wrong. And if I plot that as a curve, because it's sometimes very nice to see how these functions go just in a single plot, I'm plotting here scalability, size, if you will, on the y-axis, and on the x-axis I'm plotting the weight of the system, just generically. And if I compare the weight function, of course it's going to be linearizing, that's the diagonal line that you see. And then the strength, that's the cross-sectional area on this particular plot, it ends up being a curve. I won't explain any detail what it is, but it's going like power to the two-thirds, actually. So it's sort of like a square root type of function. So the point about it is that the two curves end up crossing. So as you increase the weight or the size of the system, you move away from the origin. Then at some point, everything looks okay at the small scale, but as you increase the scale, eventually these two curves cross. And that's the critical point where the giant's kneecaps break or explode, the beanstalk collapses, or the bridge falls down. So the question now is there a similar kind of thing going on in computational systems, computer systems? And the answer is sort of. There's the obvious case where things just pathologically break. I'm not too interested in that because you can't really measure scalability and performance when things just flat out break. So let's assume we're not talking about pathological breakage. We've actually fixed any functional issues. And then the scalability issues turn out to be a little bit more subtle than what I've just shown you for the typical engineering problem. Because you can have linear scalability, just like in the previous diagram, that's the diagonal line. But that's, of course, what everybody dreams about. That as I add more users or more load or more traffic into the the system, the system is able to provide the same level of performance by multiples of that load. That would be, you could call it equal bang for the buck, so it could be a linearizing curve. But we know that in reality that's actually very, very hard to achieve. You can achieve it, but it's very, very difficult, and it's not the general case. It's very, very difficult. It's not impossible to achieve in general. There are special cases where you can do it. People in HPC are going to try to do this kind of thing a lot. So more generically, we get a curve that falls away from here. That's the one in the middle I'm showing you in this big plot. And you see it's falling away from here, and actually it would eventually just reach a plateau, a ceiling. So that as I increase the load, the scalability of the system would start to become constant beyond that point. So that's an effect that a lot of people see. And that's actually, turns out, tied up with something called Anvold's law that you may have heard of. So Anvold's law provides a way of quantifying what's going on there, and I'll talk about that later. There's another case, which is much more subtle, which is where the scalability curve actually rolls over and becomes retrograde. To say, as I add more users all over the system, the throughput, for example, becomes less than it was at lower load. And this kind of thing can occur. Quite typical to see this under the right kind of control measurement environments. More difficult to detect in production systems, even though it may be there, you wouldn't necessarily see it this way. So I'll come back to explaining what this is. So I want to characterize this kind of scalability characteristics in a some kind of formal framework that I can use to modify my cost benefit for whatever scalability strategy I choose. Why do I want to do that? Because we have, you know, growing list of web 2 fails, we're doing a lot of these. Remember wheels? They just disappeared a couple weeks ago. Yeah, they're now gone. We're going to be a Google killer about 2 years ago. So each of these companies have had their fail days, some more than others. A lot of it's to do with scalability, not all of it, but a lot of it has to do with scalability issues. Particularly for popular websites where the traffic is increasing. How you do this, how you anticipate it, how you project it, and so on, is difficult, but that's what this methodology is all about. This is a kind of a lark here. The one that was the most recent one that I was looking at in any kind of detail was the one from Wolf from Alfred. Stephen Wolf, as a habit, of really overplaying things before he actually delivers them, and when he delivers them, they kind of fall short. And sure enough, same thing happened with Wolfram Alpha. This was going to be the greatest thing since Google. And on the day they finally released it, I'm showing you what is my best guess at the scalability curve. You can see it peaked at a relatively small number of users there, and then died rapidly after that. And it turns out that Wolfram himself was interviewed in the LA Times, and it was there that my scalability kind of admitted what happened. He admitted, first of all, that it failed. Didn't meet expectations, they couldn't handle the load that anticipated, even though they had millions of dollars of computer and hardware sitting behind this thing. But what I found amazing was that he said that they actually decided that they could try to simulate the respective user load before launch day and do load testing. I'm sure you all know what load testing is. Well, Wolfram's team suddenly either discovered this or suddenly thought about it the night before. And did it, and of course the whole thing fell on its face, but it was too late to do anything about it, so they knew this was going to happen, actually. So this gets back to another point, which I'm not talking about here in particular, which is if you're going to do capacity planning, that's to say, be able to handle these kind of situations, everybody understands capacity. It's the planning part that's hard to do, because there you have to have techniques and methods that allow you to see ahead. I'm not talking about crystal balls, but you do have to have methodology to be able to see what's coming. So the one thing you don't do is you don't do load testing the night before. That's a rather risky game, but of course, it fit in. Another thing, as I said earlier, that scalability is a function of a number, and it's, from time to time I see even so-called experts like some of the people at Google talking about scalability, and here's just a little piece out of the paper that I happened to come across a while ago, that so I think this is sort of like a precursor to MapReduce. So you have a lot of parallelism going on, and they were measuring the scalability of this thing, and basically the statement says that essentially, in essence, we could achieve 100%, except there are a few things like a small amount of overhead in there that don't allow us to achieve 100%, but we can get 98%. So what that means is they're saying the scalability is not one-to-one linear, it's 98% of it, so slightly different gradient. That may or may not be true, I don't know, because unfortunately, they don't give enough numbers to be able to really assess it. But the point is that statements like 98% of linear or any linear curve that, you know, is projected out without showing any kind of role is at least suspect of being true. And Theo Schlossberger points this out in his book. Actually, I'm going to quote him a couple of times on this slide because I just have to read the book on the plane on the way out from San Francisco. So he says, linear scaling is simply a falsehood, page 71. I think that's actually a bit of an overstatement. I wouldn't go quite that far because you can get linear scaling, but it's extremely difficult to get and to do a lot of work, and it's not generally applicable. So even if you can do it for, say, one application, you're probably not going to use the same technique for many others because it simply won't work that way. So, in that sense, I agree with him. At least he's making the point, and it's a good point to make, because any time you see something that looks like it's scaling linearly, as I say, it's really a suspect. Not to say it can't happen, but you should look much more closely to see how that's being done and whether you can achieve it. So scalability is a function, not a number. It's in the linearizing line. Everybody has that idea. That's what you ultimately would like to get to in an ideal sense. The question is, how are you going to get there? So and the other thing is that there are always inherent limits. In the case of the engineering limits, we have critical limits where things can actually break. In the case of computer scalability, things are more subtle, where we have, for example, throughput ceilings, the throughput maximum. You only have so much hardware once you exhaust the resources, then your throughput can't be given some number. The question is, what is that number? And more importantly, what are the numbers on the way up to that limit? That's really the other key in order to project So I want to quantify these limits and their characterization in general. So what are the components of scalability? So now I'm going to do a little bit of math, but for you math folks, no big deal, hardly in high school algebra. And another point about Theo's book is that on page 12 he has a formula, which is way more complicated than anything I'm going to tell you. In fact, I have no idea what this formula is all about. So, I don't know what it is, ask Theo, but my formula are not this complicated, so the math I'm doing is less than Theo does at his book. So, let's look at the pieces once again. Scalability is comprised of a number of components, at least that's one way of thinking about it. So, ideally, we'd like to get equal bang for the buck, so that would give us the linearizing kind of scalability curve we've often seen, marking losses and other places. So, that would be maximal concurrency being sustained at any level. Of course, we know that there's some realistic things in the system that are going to cause it to fall away from linear. Well, I happen to know exactly what that is. That has to do with contention. So any time you have resources that are shared amongst processes, users, threads, then you're going to have contention for that resource at some point. And it's that contention that is responsible for making the scalability curve fall away from the ideal linear. That doesn't make it bad. Quite a good thing. The question is, to what degree is it falling away? How fast is it falling away? And can I put a number on that? Because then I can compare things much more easily. As we increase the load, another characteristic we're considering is I actually get diminishing returns. This is the case where I've now exhausted all the resources. They're running at essentially maximum utilization. And I can't push the thing any harder. If I add more load, that's to say extend the x-axis, more load, the throughput might increase. In fact, the best case would just remain a constant plane, a ceiling plane, which is fine. And this is an option. And it will have an impact on the response time, which I'm not going to be discussing here today. That's the other side of the scalability point. They're all connected together, but I'm just looking at throughput in this context. So you reach a throughput maximum, and that may or may not be desirable. It depends on the application of what you're trying to achieve. Diminishing returns is really a result of what we call in performance analysis saturation. So something is saturated, that impacts one component of the system, right? Saturated or bottleneck. And that controls the height of that ceiling in that curve. So if you have such a thing, you know what it is that's saturated, you know what it is that's bottleneck. And if you do, you can then ask yourself, is it plausible to change that bottleneck, remove it? Actually, never remove the bottleneck, just move it. Now, there's an even worse case, and this is where I increase the load of the system, I scale it up, and now I get diminishing returns, or actually, you know, sorry, not diminishing, but negative returns. This is the sort of thing you've seen on Wall Street. If you've got any investments in Wall Street, you've seen negative ROI. the scalability function. I would like to include this effect. It's very important. I hope it's not there, or if it's there, that I can get rid of it. But if it's there, I'd like to first of all quantify it. How big is it? How big is the effect? How important is it? And what is causing it? And can I remove this methodology helps you to make those kind of decisions? So, for this, I need a model, the framework I mentioned earlier. And this is the formula, the equation. You can put it into Excel or R or whatever paper you want to use. And it's, I'm going to pull all these pieces that I showed you diagrammatically together in a formal way into the equation. So I need to specify the x-axis, which is the load on the system, the number of users or processes or threads, for example, identify that by n. The scalability function that I'm going to show you is, of course, going to be a function of that n, because that's how related to the size of the system. Here it is. So this is the formula. And it's got three pieces, so it's looks like a kind of a fraction. So on the top, you just see n. If there was nothing on the bottom of the fraction is 1, then of course things were just scaling, and every time I added more users, I would get big people, and I would have a capacity that's be equal banks of that. So there are really three C's in the denominator of this fraction. The first one is the level of concurrency. That's to say, if only that term existed and the other two didn't exist, then I would just be linearized, and that would be the shape of the function. That would be ideal scalability. That's the kind of thing that Google saw in their source of life. Second term, the second C, is contention. That's to say, I've got shared resources. Therefore, whatever the level of concurrency is in the system n, they have to share these resources. They can't all have the resource at the same time, for whatever reason, part of the architecture. And the alpha there, that group letter alpha, is simply there to tell me the strength of that particular characteristic. That's to say, the amount of contention in the system will be numerically identified the value of alpha. Alpha is going to be a number actually between 0 and 1. It's a real number, so think of it as being between 0 and 100% information. So I can therefore tell the level of contention. The third one is consistency. Sometimes I call this coherency. I'm using the word consistency because I've heard it a number of times, and this is consistency in the sense of ACID compliant databases, it's the C in ACID, or the C in CAP, right, the CAP pairing. So it's related to that kind of consistency. But now I can quantify with that third term, and in particular the coefficient which goes with that third term, which I'll just call beta. So once I know the values of alpha and beta, I can tell you how much concurrency there is in the system, relative to how much contention, relative to how much consistency. Consistency means data consistency. And the reason I call this universal, I call this universal scalability law, is because this is basically all you need. There's no reason to make it any more complex. This is complex enough. Well, it's not as complex as fields. But the other important point is that with those two coefficients, alpha and beta, in the denominator of that function, I can specify where the maximum is in the function, should it exist. So if beta, for example, was 0, then I can't have such a maximum. It's just not there. I need a value of beta that's bigger than 0 in order to get a maximum. Because the maximum may be way downstream, maybe it's even, you know, like, you know, a million users would have, so it's probably there, but I may not have to worry about it. But I'll know that in the value of the number once I figure out what these numbers are like. So let me show you how you can apply this by looking at a number of problems that I've looked at. Well, I don't have the time to go into great detail, but there's a good flavor. So we've defined scalability. I'm defining it as a function. It's a function of the size of the system or the load of the system. And I've now specified a model which I claim is universal. So therefore, I don't need any other model. We could have a discussion about more elaborate models or better models and so on and so forth. One of the other things I'm aiming for is to keep it as simple as possible. I think this is as simple as possible. I can come up with anything better than this. So having defined that, let me show you how. So the reason I want to apply this is because, as I said earlier, all measurements are wrong by definition. What I mean by that is the data comes from the devil. So there's no good reason to trust it whatsoever. I don't care whose tools they are. I don't care how many millions of dollars you paid BMC or whoever. I have no reason to trust data. By the way, I have no reason to trust really sane world, you should also be testing the tools to see if the tools, when you get them from release to release, are they really measuring the same things in the same way? If I had all the time, I could use some examples. You'd be shocked to see if you often measure the same thing in release to release. So, skepticism should rule. And I want to be able to evaluate how good this data is, given that by definition it's actually wrong. How wrong is it? And the only way you can do that is physical science for 300 years. The only way you can do this is with a model, a framework of the model, because models haven't been gone. So that's what you should be believing. So I want to combine these two things together, because that gives me insight and information. And it's another way to think of it is that it puts the data in a jail, in a prison. And I want this data to confess to me if it's true or not. So therefore, waterboarding the data is actually okay, so feel free. That should be the attitude. Just because you have numbers doesn't make them right. Anybody understand what I say when I'm saying four measurements are wrong by definition? Well, I know you probably do, but the thing we built. Nobody's going to tell you. Go ahead.
Measurements are wrong by definition because they're not the actual. Am I talking in a different direction than you're talking about?
No. Can you go a little bit more detail?
Okay, so all models are wrong, some models are useful.
All measurements.
A measurement is a model of a real quantity. An accurately floating point number is just a model of a real number.
Okay.
A weight of models real number.
That's a representation. Okay. I'm talking about data that you can look at, like measuring a database. We're going to say vanilla tables or whatever. Those data, they are wrong by definition. But what do I mean? Like, I'm saying they're wrong, it's the future attention. But what do I really mean? Yes?
The act of measuring causes the system to change. Okay. The act of measuring causes the system to change the behavior.
Okay, that's a good one. So they're saying that the act of measurement itself is the positive reference. The acquisition itself must perturb the system in some way, so the thing you're trying to measure may not be exactly the quantity expected, because the measurement process itself is imposing on the value that you're getting. That's not untrue, that's not exactly what I mean, but it's part of the picture, so yes, sir.
I was going to say, measurements have finite precision.
Yes.
Therefore, they might not contain all fully accurate data.
Yeah, okay, that's a lot. I was saying, anybody else? Somebody else over here?
It's only valid by instant.
It's only valid by the thing blowing away.
It was only valid for the instant. It was
you. Oh, I see. Mm-hmm. No, I think I don't agree with this. Maybe. So I think maybe you're actually closer. So let me explain for a second. So, first of all, measurements are not numbers. Any number is things like prime number, 11. That's numbers. The measurement is a process, first of all. You describe that if that's what you certainly true, it says that the measurement process might have some impact on the measurement. I wouldn't get too excited about that, but certainly if it's true that that's happening, and if it happens in a very adverse way, then you would certainly want to know about that, because the measurement overhead could be very significant. It shouldn't be, but it could be, so to that extent that's true. But measurement is a process. And it has inaccuracies because of this process, and so I can only sort of figure out some kind of range in which this number might be true. I don't know the actual value. I'm trying to get my hands around it by doing this measurement process, which these tools do for me. But what I want to emphasize for you is, because it's a process, and there is no number in the sense of a prime number or integer, you have the illusion, however, that it is, because these tools actually misreport this data, including big algorithms, or MP stat, you know, things that pick something. The reason is because you'll see something like, let's say, CPU busy 73%. Rubbish. No such thing. It's 73% plus or minus how much? Because I can only give a kind of an interval of range where that number is likely to be true. I know it's bigger than a certain value, and it's less than another value. It's somewhere in there. So the number that, of course, the tools are actually calculating this for you, but they're throwing away the additional information, which is the range information. The error bar, we call it, the error range. The range in which this number sits, so the 73 is an estimate of that particular measure. So your statement about it's the day and the time you measured it, that kind of ties in with that idea. It's the day I got when I did that measure. If I do a measurement again, I won't get 73, even if the system, you know, basically proves it. But I hope it's within the range of the error bar, you know, plus or minus, let's say, 3 or 5%, something like that. If it's bigger than that, which would happen also, by the way, I need to know why. What I'm getting at here is it's not your fault. What I'm getting at here is these tools lie to you. Not only they lie to you, they mislead you into thinking that it's actually 73 and therefore this number came from God because it's a prime number. This is not true. Never was true, never will be true. And because it has this error in it, it's wrong. There's no perfect value, irrespective of any representation of the Quantifying numbers. It's just wrong. So I want to know how wrong it is. What's the range of error? I'd like to know that because then it tells me how good that measurement process is. Should I improve it? Is that the best I can do? What does it mean? And so I can ask all kinds of questions. So I can start to address. I can start to address the degree to which the bell is lying to me. So that's what I mean when I say all measurements are wrong. I want to emphasize that point because it has to walk away with nothing else. If you walk away with that, I'll achieve something because I've never heard anything say this before. Physical science, we know this just by that. This is just, you know, I think that you know, we spend time in labs actually measuring stuff and then you learn how bad it really is. And so this is not really news. But the point is, that's the way the models come in. The reason I need models in the sense of the scalability law that I'm showing you is to get some idea of, you know, how well these numbers actually fit together, given that they're essentially a result of some process which has errors in it. So I'd like to get my hands around what are these error ranges, how much should I believe these numbers? And before I even start thinking about that, how can I improve? Yes, sir.
Like I said, it's a range bound, the number and lower bound.
Yeah.
But isn't that done by sampling frequency? If you let that you sound it, let's say 100,000 times, you know, you're reducing it down to, it's still present, but it's almost reduced down to a fairly, minimized down to a level that you may not
be doing. You can narrow the range by doing more samples and so on, because you're getting more information. That's sort of right. In general, it's true.
Yeah, so what you were saying earlier, like the initial model, it's like, it's always a simplified huge, which has embedded in it a series of simplified. Series of assumptions to sort of simplify the modeling or whatever it is you're modeling. As long as you understand what those predicates are, well, I'm going to assume this, I'm going to assume that, will, you know, so forth, it allows you to be able to construct the model because you can't construct, as you said, the model with further backwards. So you can say, well, I'm going to assume that, you know, when I'm plugging the value here, that, you know, I am measuring this to a level of standard.
I understand what you're saying is standard statistics. So the problem we have actually in the industry from a practical point of view is that you're often likely just to get one damn measurement. We don't have time to do four measurements. My boss says just do this, we need to ship it. You know, how many times have you heard this? So in my case where I'm even asking if you have any scalability information or any data, it's like, well, maybe they have some, in which case I'm going to give one data set, one sample at each low point. So actually, I don't even know what kind of calculator confidence is, or how to get into that kind of discussion. I'd like to if we can. So I have to live with that too. So that's okay. So anyway, let me move on and I'll show you if what happens when we get around. So I'm trying to give you some examples of how to analyze them. So here's the results of measurements. So this is the scalability measurements. That's good because often people are just measuring the top level numbers, just to say, you know, a number out of, let's say, the 200 to 350 range of users. And so things look pretty flat, so they say the maximum throughput is, you know, is it 200 or something? Whatever, you know, fiddly squats per second, you know, the metric happens to be. And other than that, it's monotonically increasing, rises up to the ceiling. So it looks to me, I'm just looking at a, you know, arguably might be a bit of roll, but it's not significant. It's probably beta in that case, it's probably pretty close to zero. We're looking at something rather like animals, or just say the alpha is a non-zero. I'll figure out what that number is in a second, I hope. But beta looks like it could be zero, so it probably doesn't roll off, that's okay. And the measurements look okay visually. By the way, visualization is a good thing, but it's not the only thing you can count, because you need to really assess the data in several different aspects of a hyper-simple vermoose. So visualize, analyze, which means you're looking for patterns, this kind of modelize, which is what I'm calling it here, the DAM, OOS, the OO is over and over until satisfied. In other words, modeling, measurement's not a one shot. It's an iterative process over and over and over. Why? Because things change. I have people tell me how fast the website changes, I can't do any of this and that. Rubbish. Iterate at the same rate as you're changing, you're doing releases or whatever. And the simpler you make your modeling scheme, then the more likely you're going to keep up. That's exactly how it should go. Scalability analysis or capacity planning is iterative, it's not a one shot. Never was, never will be. Things do move fast in modern architecture, so I certainly agree with that. Techniques are the same. But the lighter you are on your feet, the modeling, which is why I'm trying to pose this model so much, is means you stand an even better chance of keeping up with your website, even if you iterate the architecture every other day. So this looks good. So values are visualized, this looks good, and it looks sort of okay, so let's proceed to the next step. And in this particular case, I did this in Excel. In R or JavaScript, which you can download from my website. But what's interesting here, there's a problem. The data's bad. You wouldn't have noticed this by just looking at it visually. That's why I say visualization is not the only thing. You have to do a few things. Visualization is a very good starting point. I'm a visual kind of guy, I love it. In fact, I wish we had better visual tools than we have coming from some of these vendors, but it's not the only step. So what you're going to see now, as I go to the next phase, I go from visualization to start to compute some numbers, to put them into the universal scalability law to figure out what the scalability curve looks like. That's what I'm trying to do. And I go through a number of steps to do this in Excel, which I don't have time to tell you about today. About my classes and it's in my book and so forth, if you want to know more. Or maybe discuss it offline too. So the point is, what you're going to see is that some of the data, although it looks visually okay, exceeds 100% efficiency. And I don't care what it is, you cannot have that. Or if you're going to insist to me that the data is correct, then you've got a lot of explaining to do about how that works. So, the way I read this actually happened, and this is a real problem, I'm not making this up. So, I was just going to barrel on and do the universal scalability law, figure out what the scalability curve was, and back to the client and say, you know, this is what it looks like. I didn't get that far because you could see in column F. I've got in column D, I've got the load, so this is the number of, let's say, virtual users, it's generated data, so this is what we call it there, the generators, representing users or threads, for example. So that's N, the thing I've parameterized the logo, ranging between 1 and 350. Next column is the, I've calculated what's called a relative throughput, so it's basically a normalized throughput, which I'm not explaining. And then the third column, F, take that second column and divide by the first column, that's CRN, that actually corresponds physically to the efficiency. And that number can never be bigger than 1. And in fact, in real scalability, it usually should be less than 1 as you increase the load of the system because the overheads are going to be taking the cycles out of the system. And what you can see is it starts at 1, but then it increases above 100, right up to about, 150 or so generators. So therefore, I can't continue to calculate anything with my model because of all the numbers, I get negative numbers or some crazy thing, and the math just won't work. But more importantly, at this third step, the process, the methodology, I've already discovered a problem with the data. I told you, data comes from the devil, but there was no suspicion of this, and if you looked at it visually, you don't suspect it either. You have to go through the stages numerically to see it. Now, the next question became, what's causing that? And I actually wasn't even on the same continent, so that won't be next to the test rig, so I don't know exactly. My understanding is that they went and looked at this very seriously because of this problem in column F. By the way, if we haven't had that problem, can you parallel them down? Probably the application would have fallen on its face if it eventually would have been put in production. So with this warning, they then went and looked at the application and this and that, and so on, couldn't find anything causing the problem. And some amount of time, weeks went by, and the only thing that I know that they reported to me that changed was the release of JMeter. They got a new release of JMeter, and everything became kosher. I told them the tools didn't lie, so I don't know that that's exactly what's going on, but that's what I understand from a distance. So, you know, let alone attempting to do any fancy scalability models, I could even get past the third column in Excel, but that turned out to be very important because at least you found what was causing the problem. In this case, it looks like it was the tool that was the culprit. Doesn't surprise me, I was surprised, because there's a lot of implicit faith that the tool is telling you the right number. So, I didn't get to USL. It's not that I did, but I'll give you another example. This is, I think I can talk to you about this, this is what I call eBay 1. This is eBay about more than 10 years ago. The architecture of eBay doesn't look like this anymore. Partly because of this problem. So they were having very, very serious scalability problems back at that time. Essentially, they had a basically monolithic back end running in a horrible Fidelity VM data mining and so forth on a Sunday 10K. And Sunday 10K had lots of problems of its own, but at some point they've been in a ditch for about 72 hours. And at that point, what was remarkable is that eBay back then was one of the very few internet companies actually making money. Their revenue at that time was $10 million. But it was real money. And that in itself was remarkable. It wasn't based on advertising, it was based on their clip of the transactions going through the system, which is pretty big. But in the pitch for 72 hours, they had to pay a lot of money, part of that money back to the people who didn't have their transactions hacked on eBay. So this turned out to be a real headache. And so I don't know, actually I get bragging, so I don't get bragging until you have some violent pain. And so the point is that I did a lot of analysis, which I don't have time to close that frame, which itself is pretty interesting, but what I just wanted to show you was I reached a point where I wanted to assess something about the workloads that were running on eBay, but eBay at that time was sufficiently naive that it didn't have any group attached to doing those kind of measurements. They were just in the QA group together. If they had had the QA group together, possibly I could have gone and stolen some of their load test measurements, but they didn't have any separate group and hadn't even informed them. They were moving in the right direction, just though not quickly enough for me. So there was no real scalability data that I could draw on. So I was there working with Sun, actually, and their professional skills hired me with something they call their index, the set of numbers that their field engineers use to work with customers to scale their systems. And anyway, so I was very grateful for getting 7 days, although I can go across different models from Sun architectures and hardware side, and then I look at the MVAs and I can figure out how to scale and so on and so forth. So that it's not ideal because it's not their application, but at least it's something to work with. And then I ran into a problem. The problem was that when I looked at the MVAs and calculated the alpha value for my universal scalability work, it tended to be the equivalent of 0.5% contention. So whatever workload Sun was using internally to cover these MVAs, it's unrealistic. It's unrealistic from the point of view of this client, despite being human. Because I know from experience that typical sort of alpha values one expects is more in the range of 3% for something running Oracle, which this was. Now I have a problem because I don't want to piss off Sun because they gave me the MVAs. On the other hand, I don't want to lie to eBay either. They're going to figure out whether they need to buy more E10Ks. By the way, fully loaded E10K, 64 CPUs back then was $5 million. The revenue was only $10 million. So this was a very, very good decision for me. So I wanted to be somewhat more realistic. So what I was able to do then was I was able to take the Sundays, sort of think of it as one side of the envelope, the optimistic side, let's call it. Then I could run the same numbers, but with my alpha value, which I think it should be closer to 3% to represent Oracle. That would be the other side of the envelope. And eBay's mileage would vary in there. So I'm giving a range, and at least the end values provide a way of quantifying things, otherwise we have no numbers in town and so on. So it's really useful, and not ideal, but they were useful. So then I was able to generate curves like this, but basically what I'm projecting here is time on the x-axis weeks, and this is across two or three financial quarters. And 100% on the y-axis means that's one fully loaded E10K being consumed. 200 means two of them, because they only had one of the active on the back end at the time. So what I showed them basically was if they didn't act now and write the check, if they did it any longer, then the traffic would continue to grow to the point where by the time Sun actually built the machine, brought it to eBay, installed it, installed Oracle, and got the whole thing running again, you could really be exhausted by the time they actually had the thing running. See what I'm saying? So you pay your $5 million, if you do it late enough, you don't get any advantage because by the time you build a machine, the new traffic just consumes all the capacity almost instantly. It's a waste of money. They got the message, by the way. I didn't think they did, but they did. So together with the sun data on offer and present as an envelope in which their scalability exists. So basically, the whole set of curves, you can see the different curves correspond to different sun models, different number of CPUs, it operates and patches and that kind of stuff. And then I had an equivalent set of curves. This is the optimistic values of the sun, these are my curves, my realistic values. So use both, and then it's up to them, up to the data side, the data side. That's all another thing. Last example, scalability. So we've been discussing about scaling up, scaling out. Memcache is a pretty nice piece of software for building easy scale out. So if you have tiers of model servers, which are typically single CPU blades, you can dedicate them to running instances of Memcache, and if you have a few value pairs, and a lot of big websites are using that. And in that case, single threading is okay. The issue that I think a lot of people have recognized is that eventually that hardware gets rolled, and when it's rolled, it's going to be replaced. What you replace it with, of course, is the next generation of quantity hardware. Talk about this morning about some of the liabilities of doing that, but you're forced into it because you're not going to make your own processor, so you're going to buy it from somebody, Intel or IBM or Harry Allison or whatever. And more than that, the most important thing that's changed, I think a lot of people haven't completely recognized this, because the vendors pull the fast one on everybody. They didn't talk about it at all. The fast one is basically before and after Moore's law term. So up until now, or recent times, you're able to get more CPU cycles at a higher clock rate. So just keep doing whatever you're doing. If there's some bulk in the code that can be handled by more instances later on in the cycles of the next generation of hardware. The problem is, you can't do that anymore. Any of you know why that's not happening anymore? So I don't think I've seen 6 gigahertz parts. Probably someone told me on the wire, but no 10 gigahertz parts. I think, like, you know, why not? Yep.
Will you start to run into speed of light or speed of electron issues?
No. That would be like 20th century issue. The issue is a 19th century issue, yes.
These traces are so small that the electrons are jumping across traces.
That's part of it. The leakage is actually negated. But yeah, there's leakage is a problem. So it's not the main problem, but it is a part of the problem. Where is it from? Yes.
Heat.
Say that word again.
Heat.
Magic 4 letters. I thought it was the 19th century physics. They killed by thermodynamics. When you increase the clock speed, you increase the capacity of heating, and the wires can also melt. They leak, but they also melt. And they melt, tend to melt first when you increase the. It's a function of CMOS. Everybody who does the other side knows this. So if you want to make your CMOS run faster, pour liquid nitrogen. Heating is a real problem, so the wires can melt, all the things just fall apart. And so the industry pulled the switch and said, well, we can't build a faster processor, so let's just put more cores in the same module. And that's called multiple. Now, I have no problem with that, except for the fact that they didn't really talk about that. They pulled that switch without anybody knowing, really understanding what the impact of that is. That means you're now talking about an SMP on a chip. So if you don't have to program SMPs, you're going to have some interesting time. I used to work for a company called Pyramid Technology, where we had multi-processor Unix boxes. So I would say 70% of the development time was spent trying to tune the damn code and run on these systems, and yet we've all done it many, many times before. You think that once you've got over the hump, you just know how to do it automatically. As soon as you change one thing, it all goes to hell all over again in some different way. So the point is that the multi-cores are not a decision that you made, it's a decision that got made for you by the vendors. Therefore, you will have no choices about Brian Campbell talked about this morning. You have no choice. It's a black box. You live with it or not, because you can't go to a different vendor because they're all using the same technology model because of the heating problem. So that's a vendor decision. And therefore, if you eventually the hardware that's say you're running Memcache, you know, will become multiple, you know, some number of reps. And what we discovered was is that the current instance of like these three releases I mentioned here in particular are thread limited to about 6 threads. Even though scalability has been advertised as improving, it really doesn't show up here. So let's look at this in more detail. We actually model some more detail. So here's the performance measures of the system. And this is a set of control measurements made by colleagues at Sun, people that are in the position. And then I put this into Excel like I did before with a JMeter data. And I do my thing for the Scalability level. Or I can do it in R, if you go to my script on my website. And then you produce curves like this. So here I'm showing, by the way, the lower right-hand curve shows you the error margin around the curve. These are your centimeter points, one data point per live day, that's all I can ever get. And the blue line is the universal scalability law, so that's the theoretical model that's compliant with those data points. Notice it doesn't go through every data point because we're not curve fitting, we're modeling. And the gray envelope around the outside is the error margin, so I expect the curve to sort of sit somewhere inside that. And then as a consequence of that, we're able to find out running on Intel hardware, so this is Solaris running on x86 hardware, two socket, hypercritic and so forth. You can run up to roughly about 350 or so pops of 1,000 operations per second. And so that's pretty scalable. If, you know, ideally, you think like we get one thread per user, that's a lot of users, so that's not necessarily that ideal. This is the maximum sort of value you expect. Just look at the alpha beta values I calculated for each version. See the first one, the first row of the table is about 2.5%, and then going up to nearly 10%. So that's actually getting worse. The beta values are remaining pretty consistent. So something's going on with alpha. And that NMAX day in the last one was computed from the days of alpha beta, so that also increased the data. What Sun did was they looked at this thing running on their Spark architecture where they could throw T2 at it and have 32 to 48 threads or something running per alpha call. And also, in addition, they we worked out a software patch which allowed scalability to improve up to an NMAX of somewhere between the range of, say, 20 to 40 or so threads. So it can be done. I don't believe it's been backported into the open source yet. Whether you would get that same 2x improvement on thread scalability on Intel architecture, that's not clear. We can measure that separately. Because there may be other limitations in that commodity hardware that doesn't exist in the Spark CNT, for example. So the way this was achieved by was by partitioning this pattern. Basically distributed cache table, which is interesting. So it's certainly lower than they would offer, and could scale up the model. So why should you be interested in trying to use methodology like this? Well, it's one of the variables of the Amazon form. Scalability is too complicated to be an afterthought. It should be designed in. If you're going to design it in, you should know how to assess it, what the cost benefit is you have to do numerically. Also, this business of concurrency is going to come back, I think, somewhat ferociously, so that people who become lazy and used to running single threaded code are going to have an interesting time trying to run efficiently on multiple cores. And if you're not running efficiently, then why do you have it? You're going to pay some money, it would be an additional CPU cycle you might be able to use if you don't have to do concurrent threaded programming. And also, it would help to reduce user latency to scale up. And so it's difficult, and it's mostly that effect would be contained in the beta term, that's that third term that dominated the USL, the beta function, beta term. And as Theo says, simply having a solution that scales horizontally, as you have to say the main PhD, doesn't mean that you're safe. True words that have spoken. Finally, just let me mention one way this could be extrapolated is you could use the alpha and beta values for your applications that you work with as a way of classifying the workload types, that's to say, you know, rather than saying the actual application name, you could identify it by its alpha and beta value and put it into a different category, which would be a scalability category. Because I can do this now that I have things numerical. Final thing is I've been showing you the scalability curves, how to calculate scalability curves. That's the usual way things are done, that's the way I normally do things too. However, sometimes you see data like this with dots beyond the data, and the applications seem to wander. something happens, an unvariable happens, and it starts to wander over on that lower curve, and I can identify this region because I know at a very fundamental level what the USL is trying to tell me, that the US is going to be more means. And I don't have time to explain this today, but it's basically rooted in queuing theory, and so I can actually talk to you about possible queuing effects, which relate to things like synchronous versus asynchronous messaging. And if you think about that intuitively, you know, asynchronous messaging probably better than synchronous messaging, and most programmers know that. But this also tells you numerically that if it's not behaving well, it's not scaling well as it is in here, it will tell you why. And in this case, it's worst case synchronous messaging is actually coming into play as you're increasing. And then we have a separate discussion about where we want to move the optimum to, and so on. So all these things are possible now because I've identified numerically. So this is just a by way of showing you a generalization of this whole methodology. So, if you're interested in more of this, obviously I know this little parable about fishes. I can talk to you all day, go and find fish for you when you're hungry, or I can teach you how to fish. That's the better alternative. So, if you want to learn how to fish, I have some training classes where I discuss this sort of thing in detail with all stories and examples. Otherwise, it's in my book, chapters 4 through 6, and then you go to that third link. USL tools is actually scripts and spreadsheets you can download if you'd like to try this yourself on your own day. And feel free to contact me and I can help you out because I want you to do something like this. And so there's my performance if you want to contact me. So that means I'm done. Thank you for your attention. I'm going to have any questions if you have them. Must be a high vision call.
You talked about using yourself to sort of measure where your rat is right now and sort of maybe project out exactly, you know, get the suggestions as to where it's going to max out.
So that's what we're using here.
Right. But you also, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, you also sort of said about measuring the general ROI about maybe switching to an alternate technology to sort of satisfy. How, if you've never used this sort of technology, how are you going to sort of quantify what is the necessary value?
Yeah, I didn't actually show you explicitly. The reason I don't get into any great detail is because the way people make those kind of assessments tends to differ shot by shot, and priorities are the most important thing. Basically, what we've been trying to do is combine this kind of scalability data, let's say in your spreadsheet, with a set of financial data you have in a spreadsheet. So if you made certain assessments based on the scalability calculations and says we should go to this kind of hardware because our alpha beta factors are now look like this, even if they're just estimates, you then look on the financial spreadsheet and see how much is that going to cost the budget. Or you know, CapEx. So there's no really clean way of doing it, it's very much dependent on how shock does it. Once I got these things numerically, I can see alpha and beta is better for some type of hardware or certain applications. Then I can look at my CapEx spreadsheet and see how much is that going to cost me, is that the right way to go? Because even if I get better scalability on a certain platform, let's say, it just might be too expensive and I don't want to spend that kind of money. So then I have to fall back to what might be otherwise regarded as a lesser scalability solution, treated analytically, but it's now constrained by the financials rather than just performance. And ROI means, by ROI, what I meant there was often you get marketing projections about
on the financial, but on the technician standpoint, that if you know that you're not happy with the system you've got, that it's not going to fit you to where you need to, want to entertain alternate selections of different technologies, which you are in the system, you have to be able to qualify to say to your boss, regardless of how much it costs, how much more is this going to buy? And how will I be able to quantify that?
Thank you.